Hey guys, we've been in Kenya now for 1 year, and you asked the questions, so we've got the answers. If you're wondering what you're hearing in the background, it might be our kitty cat Precious, who has decided that he should make noise at the time that we record. But other than that, thank you so much for asking your questions. We hope we'll answer them in a way that makes sense to you.
The children love to sing. They oftentimes will prepare a presentation for us when we go to a church or visit a school, and it's so awesome getting to see their presentations and the work that they put in to share love to us and to share their joy with us. So yeah, it's such a great thing that we get to be a part of here.
I think one of the things that was really unexpected for us is how much culture changes throughout Kenya. Culture changes based on the region that you live, based on the ethnicity that you are, based on the religion. Culture changes so much throughout Kenya. For example, some people are native Kenyans. Some people are Kenyans who are of British descent. Some people are Kenyans who are of Indian descent. And we've seen that throughout Kenya, culture plays a role in so many different ways around the country, yet they're all still Kenyans.
One of the most special memories that we've had over this past year in Kenya has been the opportunity to reconnect with some people that we had the opportunity to visit in 2019. For example, there's a family in a village that we got to visit in 2019 that has 4 children and one mother who is raising them. And when we met them in 2019, we did not know that we would be seeing them ever again. We did not know that we would have an opportunity to react with them anymore. But this year, we had the opportunity to see them. We had the opportunity to visit their church. They had been praying for us. They had celebrated us when we got married. And it's been a real blessing and a full circle God moment that we had the opportunity to reconnect, to stay in touch, and also that they remembered us, that they cared for us, and that they celebrated some of our life moments, even though we weren't here with them. So that's one of the most special things that we've encountered over a year here in Kenya.
One of the more difficult cultural adaptations we've had to make here in Kenya is dealing with the fact that this is an honor-shame culture, meaning that in everything you do and say, you always want to bring honor to yourself and honor to your family and honor to those around you. You never want to bring shame on yourself or on those you care for. For this reason, everything that we say to a Kenyan now has a new filter than we would have used when we were living in America. For example, if somebody's done something wrong, you're not going to just tell them they were wrong. You're going to help them to know what to do as a way of bringing honor and not shame to the situation. This is also one of our biggest challenges in ministry. Because this is an honor-shame culture, we don't always get a straight answer from somebody. And that makes it difficult to always know exactly what is happening or what the expectations are. So that's one of the biggest adjustments we've had to make culturally since moving to Kenya.
We love Kenyan food. We get to eat it about every day for lunch. We normally have rice and beans or lentils and vegetables with it. So we have definitely adjusted to the food and we've grown to love it so much. And one added benefit that we didn't know we would get when moving here is the opportunity to eat some amazing Indian food. It's one of our favorite places to go when we have a night out, and it's a great treat for us to get to have.
One of our favorite things about Kenyan culture is that it's incredibly community-oriented. Anytime there's a wedding, or a funeral, or a graduation, or any reasons to celebrate together, the community comes together and they celebrate. They celebrate big, and they celebrate loud. And the whole community helps fund those types of events also. On the flip side, even though the celebrations are a favorite part of our culture, one of the biggest struggles in the culture is that we have weddings in the front of our house very regularly. And so some weeks it's like we're attending 2 weddings a week because they're loud and they're in the field in front of our house, but the celebrations are a lot of fun.
I guess a habit that we've formed is every morning before Alicia wakes up, I start making our coffee. And Alicia has been so great and helped me get a coffee bar set up in our our place, and it's been a real blessing, a great way to wake up in the morning, just relaxing and being comfortable. And also another thing that we do is after every time we take a trip or do something new different than what we've done before, we go and get milkshakes. It's just a little way that we can celebrate the little victories that we get to have on a weekly or monthly or however often basis.
One of the more difficult things we've had to overcome is not having Amazon and not having Chick-fil-A. But on a more serious note, we've also had to learn to rely more on one another this year and to rely more on our relationship with Jesus. When we were living in the States, we had our friends close by who were a support and an encouragement to us. And even though we still have many people who encourage us from afar, the people we have instant access to are one another in Jesus. So this past year, we've learned to grow more reliant on one another and on a relationship with Jesus.
The weather's great. We've got two rainy seasons and two dry seasons, and the temperature doesn't range a whole lot, maybe like 55 to 85, and it is a great environment to be in. I think that this year we have learned a lot about ourselves, more than maybe we wanted to know, but that's a good thing, I guess. It's a growing thing, and it allows us to make mistakes with one another in our marriage, and allows us to learn from those and to better trust in who we are and who we are as a married couple and as a team as we get to do ministry together. So this year it's been hard being away from friends and family, but that's also helped us to find ways to trust and rely on one another in a better way, in a more way that is complete and full, to better our marriage and better our ministry here.
Here in Eldoret, we live in a neighborhood with a fair-sized yard in front of us. We have a two-bedroom, two-and-a-half-bathroom house, and in many ways, it's similar to living in America. We have some things that we brought with us that we've used to decorate our house, but we've also bought some things here that we've used to decorate our house. The biggest difference would be that there's no heating and air, so when it's warm, you open up the windows, when it's cool, you shut the windows and build a fire. We also cook on a gas stove most days, and we also heat our water for the shower with an electric shower head, so there's a switch that you hit that turns on the electricity, and that provides hot water for us, and we thank God that there is a way to receive hot water for showers here in Kenya.
For the most part, speaking with an interpreter is very nice, especially an interpreter that we've worked with before or worked with many times. So there are some people now who can begin to predict words and phrases that we're going to say and that we use often. So it's really nice to have someone who can kind of compliment you. And also, it's nice because if I speak a 45-minute sermon, then really with a translator, it comes up to like an hour and a half. So that helps me because I don't have many words to say most of the time.